And Morgan was a really huge success story for this. So as some of you might know, Morgan School District and community opted out of the last 3 years of the SHARP survey. They had no local data. Weber Morgan, as an LSAA, was just sort of left with just Weber data for their planning. And we were able in Morgan to really mobilize the locals in terms of not just really positive community members, but also folks from the school, from the health district, from Weber Morgan Health, just from all parties to really mobilize and to present the SHARP survey in a positive way to the school board to get school board support. And Morgan did the survey with tremendous success. So one of the main concerns in the past for Morgan was that no parent would actually want their child to take it. However, Morgan was able to gather about 90% of their consent forms back, and an overwhelming majority of those parents that returned their consent forms opted in for the survey. So Morgan was just a really great success story. They have really tremendous data now that they can use. And it was just a good example of how you can take any community that's kind of dragging their heels, and with a lot of really good planning and that vocal local support, really make SHARP work. We also saw a lot of really great opportunities, or a lot of really great examples of how SHARP has been used as a community builder. So Morgan is a good example how the community really rallied around this data, and then are also rallying around the application of that data. But SHARP always provides us this learning lesson. It's usually what I find. In terms of what we need for 2019, really, if you've helped us with SHARP, it's essentially just, let's just keep on doing what you guys have been doing in the past, which is really wonderful advocacy, really great support and boots on the ground. But if you're new to SHARP, or if you haven't been as involved in SHARP in the past, these are just a few things that we recommend, especially now, before we even start recruiting SHARP participation. This is the perfect time to really kind of do these steps and take these efforts, so that when those recruitment packets go out and before we start doing SHARP, that everybody in your schools are bought into the SHARP survey. So the first thing that we need your help with is just sharing and using the SHARP data. So in communities where the data is not used, or where local prevention folks aren't vocal about using SHARP, it's very easy for a superintendent or a principal or a teacher to just say, dismiss SHARP as just one other thing that the State Board of Education is having them do, even though that's a falsehood. It's really easy to dismiss it if they see no application in our community. So anytime that you share or use SHARP data, you are, honestly, it is the very best thing that you could do to ensure the success of SHARP in general. Right now is the perfect time to find allies. Whether you are a community that your superintendent is always supportive of SHARP, or whether you're in a community where you maybe have a new superintendent or the support is not really high, but just finding allies in your community, other people that use SHARP data or other people that would like to, parents that are supportive of the survey, teachers that are supportive of it, really kind of find your allies, just say, reach out to them and just say, okay, 2019 SHARP is coming. You know, how should we prepare? But just kind of getting your ducks in a row and kind of figuring out who your people are, your SHARP people, now is the perfect time to do that. Reaching out to your administrators. And like Melissa said, this doesn't just include your superintendents, but this is also your principals, your teachers, your parents, your students. But just reaching out to these parties. The superintendent is, of course, the most important person at this point. But just reaching out as a SHARP advocate. So letting these people know that you use the data a lot. Not only do you use it, but it's very important to the work you're doing, which relates directly to helping to improve the lives of children. And then also just reaching out and letting them know that you do have support and assistance you can offer. A lot of times superintendents don't realize that the locals would be happy to help with survey administration, or they would be happy to go over a profile report with them. But using this opportunity to not just tell them why the data is important, but also to offer your assistance, it is not just a great way to kind of make SHARP seem less overwhelming, but it's also a really great opportunity for you guys to build that relationship and that rapport with your local administrators. We also always need your help answering questions and being a SHARP truth teller. So we all know those folks in our communities and in the state that really dwell in the SHARP falsehoods or the data collection falsehoods about SHARP in terms of, you know, it's sponsored by the narcotics organization, or it's something that's kind of a big brother that we collect student you know, social security numbers and IDs, and these things just aren't true. So we always need your help in just answering questions when somebody is new to SHARP or misunderstands what it is, if they try to incorrectly tie SHARP to something that it's not connected to. We would hope that you would step in as a SHARP advocate and as somebody who's just knows what's going on and answer those questions the best that you can. And if you answer them, to take the step to hook them up with myself or someone else at Bach-Harrison who can help. Again, offering survey support is always something that is helpful. Some districts inevitably need more help than others, but even just offering support in terms of, okay, can I help come and meet with your IT staff to talk about the online survey? Or can I help come and assemble survey packets for teachers? Can I come to a faculty meeting and talk about the importance of SHARP? Can I come and talk to your faculty about some of the data that we've gotten from SHARP? Offering any kind of survey support, again, not only makes SHARP seem less overwhelming to them, which even though it is a straightforward survey process, it can, honestly, just even having active permission can make it seem like a big, big effort. So offering that support is a win-win, not only a win for them in terms of they get support, but a win for you, and that it allows you to really build those relationships. We also need your help this year providing specific support regarding the 2019 survey considerations and changes. And this is definitely something, and I'll get into some of these, that we could use the support on a number of levels, not just for administrators that have questions and want to try out some of the new things that we're offering, but also for teachers that need to better understand what's going on, for principals, for parent and student groups. But honestly, anytime that you can just offer support and you can help us to reach out parties affected by SHARP, really just sort of the better SHARP goes. So I want to switch gears, not just to kind of those overarching, these are the things that we're hoping that you do right now to help us gear up for SHARP, but I want to specifically shift to some specific considerations for 2019. So these are new things, or maybe things that your communities haven't tried, but I want to cover these because these are the ones that we need you to be knowledgeable about but when we roll SHARP out. So the first one is that we're going to be making a bigger push for online surveying. There are many benefits to do the survey online. It takes students about a solid 10 to 15 minutes less to take the survey online than it does to take it in paper pencil format. When schools are able to do it, it's also really great for your survey coordinators in terms of they send the survey links out, teachers or survey proctors administer the survey, and then there's no paper shuffling. There's no shipping materials back to us. The conclusion of the survey is very, very easy, and it also allows us real-time tracking of the survey results. So when it comes to paper surveying, we have to get the materials back, they have to be scanned, etc., before we can really see how many 6th, 8th, 10th, and 12th graders took the survey. But when students take it online, I can tell you exactly as the students are taking it, the number that's completed by grade. So it really helps us to just really track the surveys better. Students also for online surveying tend to be a little bit more honest in their in their responses, we weed out about half of students who take it online, or half of dishonest, or I'm sorry, the paper survey dishonest rates are about twice as high as they are for online surveying. And I don't know if that's because students are just able to get through the survey faster. So sort of the, I don't know, the desire or just sort of the appeal of the random bubbling, and if that sort of detracts from it. But students who take the survey online tend to be more focused, get through the survey faster, and also respond more honestly. Something that we need your help for as we make this bigger push is to help your communities understand and be able to really vet the issue. So they need to have a serious talk with their IT folks to see if it's an actual viable option. So some things to consider online is the availability of devices. So the survey can be done in computer labs. It can also be done on iPads, Chromebooks, laptops, with laptop cards, or in a one-to-one device situation. So we're just sort of making a first a big assessment in terms of, okay, do we have enough devices to administer the survey online is the first step. The second big consideration is Wi-Fi and internet strength. So maybe you've got 10 different laptop carts that you can distribute out to your sixth and your eighth grade classes, but your Wi-Fi strength in the building really is only strong enough to handle about 30 students at a time online. So in that situation, maybe you have the devices, but your school is just not wired to handle that level of surveying. This is sometimes an issue. In most school districts, we find that they're used to doing mass surveying and testing at the same time, so this is not an issue, but it is a big enough issue that we definitely have to have this conversation with IT folks before we jump in. I want to give you just a quick sort of example, a demonstration of how the online survey works. So we organize the survey just as we would for the paper survey. We distribute out instructions to survey coordinators. We ask them to select classrooms. We ask them to gather parental permission. We ask the teachers to identify the kids that don't have consent to take the survey. And then each teacher is provided with a web link that looks like this. So this is an example from Cache School District, Millville Elementary. And all of the links are just links like this, research.net, /r/ Millville Elementary. So it's easy for students to both just click on if there's a link on their webpage or if it's bookmarked, but it's also really simple for them to type in. So essentially, students would just pop up a browser, pop open a browser, they would click on the link or type it in, and then they would just begin the survey. So I'm actually just going to click through here to the end, just so you can see how it works. But it's essentially just the same survey content. As you know, for the paper survey, we have a Form A and a Form B, and the last three the last three pages on each form are unique to that survey. So for the online, what the online will do is when it comes to the end of the survey, it will randomly assign that last three-page set. So it mimics the way that the survey is done in paper format, except students. So for example, this randomly assigned this student the last three pages from the B form. And so students would just click through to the end. I wanted to also show you in terms of when the student is done with the survey, there is also online surveying also offers a really great option for the community to add additional questions. So this is an example of some additional seatbelt use questions that were added to a number of districts for a separate project. Because we've always offered the option to gather extra questions through the paper form or the online. But a lot of districts say, well, the survey is already long enough. We don't want to have students, have them take more questions when we're already strapped for time. But because the online survey, the students can get through it faster, it makes it a little bit more appealing, or at least it makes it more possible to add additional questions to the end for students to get through it during one class period. So this is an example of how your extra questions might show up on your survey. And then students just hit submit survey. We can either set it to pop open to start the survey again, in which case maybe a student would let somebody else take their spot for a computer lab, or maybe they would hand over their iPad so somebody else could take it, but we can set that for different ways as well. So in addition to a bigger push for online surveying, we will also be offering this year a sixth grade survey. So we will have a sixth grade survey form. And then the other form will be given to students in grades 8, 10, and 12. This is in response to a lot of concerns in terms of the length of the sixth grade survey, the content, and we'll talk about that more in a little bit, but there are, of course, a lot of benefits to this. I think a lot of districts are really going to respond positively to having a sixth grade form. This is a concern that they've been voicing for a number of years. And I feel like they're really going to be felt listened to by the fact that we're offering a sixth grade form. Some issues to consider: it will require a little bit more coordination and distribution in terms of the survey coordinator making sure that the sixth grade forms get the right surveys. They'll make it just kind of add an extra step to the process to make sure that the different schools get the surveys they need. For middle schools that have students in grades 6 and 8, again, we're just going to have to, it'll take a little bit more paper shuffling and kind of handling to make sure everybody gets the survey that's intended for them. In terms of reporting, school districts will note that their sixth grade charts and tables are missing some data that we have for grades 8, 10, and 12. So that will be a little bit of a learning curve that we'll have to help districts and schools through. But I really feel like we can handle that pretty well. Also, a consideration for 2019, and this is not anything super new, but the state will be offering the option, particularly for the urban areas where now you just have a sample, for you to increase your sample size at no additional cost. The details of this are not completely finalized yet, but I do believe that the state has committed to kind of continuing this effort to allow bigger districts to get more data within SHARP, which would allow you to get stronger community level data. It would allow you to get stronger school level data. This is something that we can discuss as we move forward. So just if you're interested in this, just make note to talk about me when we get started. And then also, as always, consider adding those additional questions. If you want to add additional questions for either specific grants that you're working on, for prevention issues or problems that are specific to your community or your schools, now is the time to consider those. So we need to get to work on creating those as soon as possible, preferably before your consent forms go out. So if you want to add additional questions, now is the time to really start thinking about that. I want to shift to some specific changes for the 2019 survey. And this is new, and for some of you, this might be a surprise, and for some of you, not. But these specific changes to the survey form are small, but we're anticipating some pushback and hopefully more support than that. But these specific changes to the 2019 Utah Prevention Needs Assessment survey form for the 8th, 10th, and 12th grade form in particular comes straight from the governor's task force on teenage suicide. So some of you might be familiar with this task force. I wanted to share two quick videos that really, first of all, get to the heart of why it was created. And then the second video shows what some of the task force recommendations are. And these two videos will kind of inform how we talk about what the impact is for the SHARP survey itself. So I'm going to start the first one. And Melissa, if this doesn't work out, text me or something. Hopefully it will work out just fine.
Today I'm announcing that we will in fact form the creation of a community task force headed by my Lieutenant Governor Spencer Cox and also Representative Steve Ellison from the legislature, as co-chairs of this task force to engage and complement and work with, in fact, our state suicide prevention coalition. The scope of this task force is going to be specific, bringing together community leaders and people and stakeholders of all stripes and expertise. We're very similar to other Intermountain states that has seen a surge in, fact, teenage suicide. In fact, we find that teenage suicide is now the leading cause of death amongst our young people.
Like many of you, my life has been touched by suicide or attempted suicide. And there isn't anything worse other than the deed itself than worrying about whether a family member is on the verge of committing suicide or what you can do to help them. We believe that every person should be able to embrace his or her individuality and uniqueness, and that every child deserves a non-threatening environment where they feel like they belong.
Archer is committed to being a full participant and to working hand in hand with every single person that's been nominated to be a member of this task force. Now, of course, we are committed and concerned about these very troubling statistics. We must all come together to face this issue. And Governor, we just want to assure you that the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints is going to be a very willing participant in a community to find answers to this very serious problem.
We believe this is a community-wide effort, and Intermountain is committed to doing its part in the health system and as a member of every community across Utah to be a part of the solution.
We have lost far too many lives leading up to this present day. Last year, we lost 44 children to suicide. I calculated that represents about 3,000 years that these children could have lived collectively had they not lost sight of hope for just one potential moment. But if they know that they're not alone, if they can find someone who believes in them, someone who can give them hope, if we together as a coalition, if we as a state, if we as communities, if we as family members, and if we as human beings can find ways to reach out to every individual, we can stop this. We can prevent this, and we can do it together. Thank you very much. We appreciate you being here.
Okay, so that gives, I think, a pretty fair overview of the governor's task force and the really tremendous collective effort that has gone into it. So for those of you on the phone, if you couldn't see the video, we had the governor in there. We had the chair, the CEO from Intermountain Health, but we also had Elder Rasmussen. We had other members from the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. This is just a really tremendous effort. Honestly, I've never seen this level of collaboration, including with the main representative from Equality Utah, that are coming together to really talk about this issue of youth suicide and teen suicide. And some of the recommendations specifically related to SHARP in terms of questions that we will be adding to the survey. That really will allow this task force to do their work and specifically to provide more data to do their job. So before I get into the specific changes for the SHARP survey, I wanted to kind of go over their recommendations. The full recommendations can be found in this online link, and I would encourage you guys, actually I'll just pull it up. I would encourage you guys to just go through this to get a sense of kind of where the task force is coming from, specifically what it has in relation to SHARP, and use that as a communications tool. Again, if there are questions about SHARP, we would hope that you would pull off these tools to better talk about the issue. And SHARP is specifically named in the recommendations as a source that the state will be using to gather better data. So I want to The second video is, again, really short, and it goes through some of the task force recommendations in terms of a direction that they're moving, and you'll kind of get a sense of the data that we'll be using SHARP to gather. And I hope this one works. This video is not really helpful for me anymore. Let's see. Okay, let me give it a go. I think there's an advertisement at the beginning. Sorry about that.
If you were someone who needed an organ transplant in order to live, would you take it? If so, are you willing to give? Please sign up today at yesutah.org.
Yeah, the governor issued a mandate for the task force to publish a report on ways to combat our outrageous suicide rate, and today they made that report public. Doves were released outside the state capitol this morning, symbolizing victims of suicide and those contemplating it. It came as a high-level task force released a report on ways to combat Utah's youth suicide epidemic. Our state has a suicide rate 140% above the national average.
No one wants to die. People want to get rid of the pain, and we're trying to help facilitate that and make that happen.
The task force recommends expansion of crisis response, including hotlines, apps, and better training in schools, better data, and encouraging more talk about suicide and suicidal thoughts, and reducing risk factors like more mental health training, more outreach, and firearm safety.
Use a trigger cable lock or a gun safe to secure their firearms.
Some of the requests will cost money.
We're asking for more mental health counselors for elementary schools.
What we need now is more funding. We need private sources of funding. We need more public sources of funding.
The governor also wants more focus on high rates of suicide involving Native Americans, veterans, and LGBTQ children.
And I think that this is an issue that conservatives and liberals and religious folks and non-religious folks can all agree on. Kids shouldn't be taking their lives.
16,000 people.
The task force says their work isn't done, but just beginning.
I'm going to make damn sure we do something, because we cannot stand by idly anymore and let people die.
Now, the task force is urging people to contact their lawmakers to ensure that these priorities are funded. We have posted the report for you to see at fox13now.com. By the way, you can hear behind me a lot of noise.
Okay. That was, again, just a very quick snapshot of what the total recommendations offer. And I would encourage all of you to take a look at those recommendations. They can be found through that link, or this Fox 13 story is actually great. It posts the recommendations right here. And this would be a great link to share with anybody who not only wants to see the recommendations, but also kind of might benefit from just having that snapshot overview of what's going on. So what does all of this mean for SHARP? What it boils down to are three additional topics that we will be discussing in the SHARP survey. Again, these are going to be in the 8th, 10th, and 12th grade surveys. So first of all, we'll be adding a new demographics item, which will ask students their sexual orientation and then also gender identity. And in a letter I'm going to show you in just a second, it will give the exact wording for that, or at least the wording that we're talking about now. We consider this a demographics item. So along the same lines that we ask for race, ethnicity, we ask for students' family background or in terms of who lives with them. We even in terms of asking if a person or an individual has been experienced dating violence in the past year. And it gives us a measure in which we can better understand the sexual orientation, the LGBT community, and really to kind of dig into that those folks in terms of demographics to better understand and also better serve them. We will be adding to a question that relates to unlocked firearms or access to unlocked firearms. As was reported, most kids that are killing themselves in the state of Utah are doing it with an unlocked firearm that comes from their home. So we need to better understand this. And then also a little bit unrelated, but something again that really gets to the heart of helping us to better understand suicide ideation and mental health issues is we're hoping to add a series of questions that feed into a scale that will help us to gather more information on youth isolation and such. And I want to emphasize that there is wide stretching support for these very specific recommendations, not just through Governor Herbert's recommendations, the memo, the official memo, but also from just all communities within within the state, not just again our representatives, our legislators, just IHS, Equality Utah is in this, and then the LDS Church also. All of these people played a part in coming up with these very specific recommendations. In terms of talking about this, so some of you might completely be bought into this. Some of you might be on the fence. Some of you perhaps are bought into the need for gathering this data, but are unsure about how you're going to talk to some people in your community that might drag their heels on this. So I wanted to give a little bit of information in terms of how we recommend talking about it, the talking points that might guide you through this discussion. So the first one is that we understand that this is new and change for some people is not their favorite thing. So we're really launching a thoughtful launch of these changes. So right now we are creating a letter that will hopefully be signed by the task force that we're going to send out to superintendents for the recruitment packets. It will give them kind of the whys, why are we doing this, why is it important. It will allow them an opportunity to return more to us. Says that they're not sure about it, you know, I would like to talk to somebody about it. We're really kind of opening it up, opening up the conversation in a similar way that we started doing SHARP in 2003. So when we started doing SHARP, this was a new effort. The idea of collecting data statewide scared a lot of folks. And that first year of SHARP, we had a lot of face-to-face discussions. We had a lot of meetings with superintendents where we talked about why data collection was important. And we see this as a new year in which we're going to have a lot of those conversations too. And we're asking locals, as we did with SHARP at the beginning, we're asking locals to really help us to head up these why discussions. If these discussions come straight from Bach-Harrison, we're often seen as the outsider, we're often seen as just the research agency who's ready to, I don't know, to sell their data to anybody, which is not true, but we're hoping that the locals such as you can really help us to head up these discussions to make it more personal for your communities. So some talking points. At the heart of it, adding the sexual orientation item and gender identity items really just allows us to gather legitimate demographics information. So like I said before, the survey already helps us to better understand different race and ethnicity groups. It helps us to better understand the differences between male and female students. It allows us to understand how students in a foster home setting have different risk and protective factors or are struggling more with things than students that come from a two-parent home. The survey already helps us to understand different subgroups by age, by gender, and just consider if your profile report didn't have the data broken down by anything. It didn't tell you what the data was for different grades. It didn't provide any data by male or female status. It wouldn't be that helpful. So adding a sexual orientation item really just gives us another level of demographics data in which really amazing prevention folks like yourself can do work to make sure that we're serving every child. Beyond the governor mandate, leadership at all levels and for all groups, from, again, the LDS Church to Equality Utah, agree that we need this data to inform suicide efforts and to create change. So you guys are all data users. You know, if we don't have data, we're just taking a shot in the dark. So if we have identified a problem, we need data to better understand it and to do our work. If this talking point ever comes up with you, I would again just recommend that you share these videos, share the recommendations as you need to kind of better inform the discussions you're having. Another talking item in terms of hopefully kind of easing the concern a little bit is that the sexual orientation items will not be on the sixth grade form. So students will not get this until they're in the eighth grade, and hopefully that will ease some of the concerns that folks have about asking kids these questions. Another concern that we have heard is that this data is going to be made public at a local level, and then all of a sudden we're identifying kids and kind of pointing out the kids that do identify as LGBT, and that's not the case. So The data release will be just as we have for any other administration. School and district level data will be property of the district, and not only regional or LSA and state level data will be released to the public. So all of those same data level protections will be there. And there's also just an incredible need for this data. And I'd like to just kind of take a couple slides to talk about the need. And then we'll open it up for questions. So the next few slides honestly are very wordy, and I'm not going to read these to you, but these are specific talking points that the Department of Health came up with in terms of talking about the need for why this is so important. So as the clips mentioned, youth suicide in Utah has increased 141% just since 2011. And specifically, this is a problem related to teenagers. The CDC, when they came in to help Utah specifically with their health-related findings, specifically identified the need for more data to kind of figure out what was going on behind suicide. Again, the governor's task force specifically mentioned the need for very specific data regarding sexual orientation and gender identity. The need for this data is very clear through the recommendations. National studies show that LGBT youth grossly contemplate suicide at almost three times the rate of heterosexual youth. They're almost five times more likely to have attempted suicide compared to heterosexual youth, which really drives down to the point that this is sexual identity questions. They might seem new to a lot of us older people, but this is a demographics reality that we're seeing across the country, and it is a demographics group that we just need data for to really understand. And then the need is also made clear by our very own SHRP survey data. So you've probably all seen this slide in terms of data regarding past year suicide considerations, past year suicide planning, and past year suicide attempts increasing for all grade levels since 2011. When we first started collecting this data, we kind of thought that this was a fluke, but this is an honest to goodness trend. We need data to understand. We can see in terms of past year suicide considerations by your regions, every region is seeing an increase of suicide consideration. So Tooele County is the only exception. There was a slight decrease there, but really this is not just an urban problem. This is not just a problem for Salt Lake County. This is suicide ideation attempts. This is something that we're seeing statewide, which is the reason why the state is pushing to have this on the statewide survey. And then some of you who have been to some of my other presentations on SHRP 2017 data have likely seen this. So we asked kids, if you've been bullied in the past year, what are the reasons you've been bullied? And this is of the kids who marked those individual items, of those kids, the percent that had made a suicide plan in the past year. So this is not suicide considerations. This is actual suicide plan in the past year. This line is the state's baseline or the state average. And you can see that of the kids who marked that they were bullied because of their perceived sexual orientation, over half of those kids have made a suicide plan in the past year. And it is some of this data that has, again, prodded the state to say, okay, we don't need, we really just need to understand this. We really need to figure out how we can help these kids just as we help other kids. And again, I want you to kind of see it as a demographics question. So much in the same way that this chart, which is of those students that said that they had past year dating violence or who had experienced past year dating violence, the percent of those individuals that were depressed, were considering suicide, had a suicide plan, or had attempted suicide. Just the same way that how SHRP allows us to look and understand these different groups of people that are experiencing different things through these different relationships in terms of mental health, suicide, substance use. This is just another level in which we can help to better serve the kids in the state of Utah. So I've talked for a good amount. We still have about 8 minutes left, but I would love to hear from you either through the chat boards or verbally, if you have questions. Are there needs that you have? Are there success stories that you want to share in terms of how you have been able to really mobilize your community for SHRP? But I will, I'll mute myself and see what comes up, and I'll pay attention to the chat.
There was a question in the chat box
says, will local health departments be copied on the letter sent to the superintendents? You know, we will be copying them. We will be copying the local substance abuse authorities, I believe. And I believe that both the health departments and the Division of Substance Abuse and Mental Health will be pushing all of these locals to follow up on the letter. So Bach-Harrison will be sending the letter. But again, we want this to be a local level discussion versus Bach-Harrison just being, again, coming in as the researcher, as the data collector, and making it a little bit more informal. But we're hoping that we can really have all of these folks as boots on the ground to help us to make sure that this is launched in a way that's and this also too reminds me that the release of these questions
you an email to send you
has has the full support of Doug Thomas of the Division of Substance Abuse and Mental Health. Craig Pavey is completely on board for this.
I've worked on it.
I might do really bad at it. I really am not proud. So be prepared to
just a quick reminder to make sure to mute your phones and your computers.
I'm sorry, I have to get on a call.
Because you're not already on one.
Oh.
Oh dear. Are there any questions specifically?
Oh, we should change this.
I have a couple of questions if nobody else had any questions. So I'm going to possibly be the one administering the survey this year. Our lady who's done it in the past is retiring. Is there a step-by-step or a checklist of things that I need to do by kind of when or who, you know, permission slips? And I mean, she's giving me some advice, like make sure you get your permission slips done, you know, at the beginning of the school year when they do their paperwork. But what are the, just being the new person, and I don't know how much she'll even help me, what are some of the things that I need to do? And also we're thinking about, you know, sampling all of our students since we're a small school. How much is it per survey and what are the steps I have to take for that? Okay, these are great questions. If you are named as our survey coordinator, as soon as the district signs on, we will send you like a full training manual that walks you through all the steps. And then at that point, you and I will be in close contact through every step of the survey. So it's definitely something where we will walk you through all of the steps and then also provide training, and we'll be there to fully support you. If you do, like for example, in your situation, Melissa, you do feel like you probably will be the coordinator, we can go ahead and start talking now, even before your superintendents have signed on. If it's something that you want to really be proactive about it, we just can't officially start planning until your superintendent has signed on for the survey. And in terms of oversampling, like I mentioned before, I believe the state will be funding those at no cost. But that is something that, again, we will be in touch about. I see there is a question for, can I share the sexual orientation questions? If you can see my screen, this is the proposed language. And also, this is the proposed letter that we will likely be sent out to superintendents. It's still in draft form. But you can see some of the new questions that we're going to add in terms of, this is the proposed sexual orientation question. This is the proposed gender identity question. We're also asking a question in terms of screen time. And then social media time, and this is the proposed gun access. And then there is a question in the chat about if we want to add questions, what's the drop dead to get them to you? So usually the drop deadline is honestly January 2019. And that's if the questions are really innocuous. So, for example, like those seatbelt questions, those aren't necessarily questions that we would need to warn parents about in your platform. If they're really heavy-hitting questions, so, for example, like Grand County asks questions on sex behavior, those are definitely those types of questions we need to talk about right now. so that we can get school board approvals, so that we can make sure that that's mentioned on the consent forms that go out, just to make sure we get our ducks in a row. So the long and the short is, if they're really innocuous questions, have a little bit of time. And I would say that we start talking about those in late fall or early winter. If they're really heavy hitting questions that you anticipate some hurdles or parental concerns about, let's talk about those right now. Any other questions or items to put in the chat?
Well, if nobody else has any questions, that was good. Thanks, Mary. One of my biggest things was, a few years ago, we went to one of our superintendents just to get approval for the survey. He was thinking about not doing it, and I was talking about it, and he opened up his drawer, pulled out this folder, and threw it on the desk and says, this is what we do with the survey, and it's taking time from the teachers and things like that. And so I had to really talk to him about why the survey was important to me as a prevention person. And we write grants, and we use it to target the issues, so we're not just, you know, doing things that we think that will work, but... and then we ended up being able to continue. It didn't go very far. I know other districts kind of struggle with getting the approval, but we just need it, you know, when they're not really participating in it and using it, they think it's just another thing in the way. And that's what he felt like. It just, we take it, it goes in the drawer. We say we're going to do something with it, and then it sits in the drawer. And so I think it's important that we are always continuously sharing our data with our communities and with our, you know, superintendents and our teachers, so they do see the value in taking this survey and continuing it in our communities. So if there's no other questions for Mary, then we'll just end for today. Just reminder, if you did join a little bit later, to go on the agenda, which the link is in the chat box, and you can mark the attendee button at the bottom that you were here, so we can get a good count of how many people are attending our webinars. And the webinar for May will be May 16th. So we haven't actually picked a topic. If there is a topic you're interested in, you could email me or respond back to Leanne in the UPCA email. We're always looking for what topics are interesting to people and what they need help with. So thanks, everyone. Thanks so much, Mary.
Hey, are you still there, Melissa?
Yes.
I'm just wondering if you could recap what you said at the very beginning about Bryce Canyon. We missed the first few minutes.
Bryce Canyon, so we're hoping that the registration will be open on Friday. We're just waiting for our last few things from the division. They'll have us a cost breakdown per person. And as soon as we have that, we'll open up the registration. So we're hoping to have that by Friday. There will be, looks like that about 15 people per LSAA will be allowed. So we just mentioned, if people are interested in attending, they need to contact their LSAA to let them know how, you know, that they're interested in going, because each LSA is only allowed 15 people. So they can divide that up between their coalitions or however they want to do that. And then at a certain point, if the spots aren't filled, we will open those up to other areas who maybe have more people than 15 that are interested in attending. So that's really what we said about Bryce. Did you have any other questions, or is that it?
No, that was it. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks, everyone.